The guided prayer is Friday the 1st. That's no first. Amen, amen. Good to see everybody in the Lord's house. I turn this one off so I can talk with this one. Good evening, everybody. Happy to be here tonight. I'm glad y'all decided to show up. Y'all didn't. It'd be looking a little weaker than it is. It's good to have everybody. We appreciate you tonight. I want to make a few announcements very quickly here tonight. Sister Pam reminded me that we're starting a meal train here at the church for Emily and Ashlyn and Alex in that situation. Now, as far as hopefully everybody's up to date, Ashlyn has gone home on hospice care. But we're going to continue to pray. I know that's not good news. That's not the report that we wanted, but we do want to continue. Let's don't give up the fight. Let's keep fighting. Keep praying. Amen. I believe that. I believe, but also know and I have faith that God is still heals, delivers. Amen. We know the Lord is sovereign. Amen. Would you say amen to that? God can do whatever He wants to do. He's not limited by our lack of faith, but He is moved by our faith. I believe that. So let's remember that. So a meal train, see Sister Pam, Everett, if you want to participate in that. And Sister Pam, they're going to could just connect with you and you'll work out the logistics of that. Perfect. So thank you, Sister, for doing that. We want to remember Harvest Sunday, the 27th, this coming Sunday here, is for all of our kids, and they're doing that down there, obviously, in the fellowship hall. We encourage all kids to come in costumes. Nothing is scary or inappropriate. This is not a Halloween type of thing. This is something that that they'll be doing for the kids. So we thank God for them, and we want to support Pastor Zach and Sister April and all the endeavors. The Senior Adult Talent and Fellowship in Kinley will be November the 21st. If you're interested in participating in the talent portion of it, please, Sister Kim. If you just plan to attend the talent portion of it, please sign up in the foyer, and the cost for the meal is $12. The deadline to sign up is November the 4th. And generally what we've done, if you sign up and if you sign up and pay your money and we go, we generally just give the money back. We're making sure that whoever signs up to go, reason why we've done that, we used to just pay for the meal, but we'd have people sign up. We'd call Kinley and tell them we got 15 coming, only 10 would come, so we're being charged for the for the five extra meals. So generally, I just refund the money back to everybody that goes. We don't have a big, but I encourage you to go. We have a great time. There's going to be some talented singers there, musicians, different things. Sister Frances won, she won 2 years, didn't she? She won our state talent in 2 years. Sister Ellen won on the piano a few years ago. She could win it every year if she went. She would win every year. And so I keep threatening. They keep wanting me to get in. I said, and do what? And I don't know what that's going to be, but I don't know. Right now, I'm not in it this year, I can tell you that. So let's be, if you want to go, it's for ages 50 over. We have a wonderful time. I'm telling you, if you go one time, you'll go every time. So anyway, remember that. This is important here. All of them are. Our annual women's conference, this is a big event for our church. It's a big fall event. Sister Kim won't be with us tonight. She has another appointment. Our theme this year is For Such a Time as This. Reverend Beth Stevens Johnson will be our guest speaker. Have a light lunch provided. Door prizes. Vendors will be set up that morning, that day, to do some Christmas shopping after the service. Please sign up in the foyer, register online on the church website if you plan to attend by November the 10th. Also, Sister Beth will be coming in. That's a Saturday. That Friday night, she'll be preaching. We'll have a revival service, one night only. Can't call it a revival, but we can call it a revival service. So please be aware of that. This is going to be a great event. It was amazing last year. A wonderful, wonderful conference. And give you an opportunity to participate in things and be active in ministry and being active and being ministered to, because these are a blessing to the congregation, senior adult talent. That's a blessing to the body of believers. So that's all I have tonight. Brother, would you bring me the prayer request list there, Brother Toole? Thank you. We appreciate it. I'll do that, and then we'll get started. You notice I'm stalling, so some singers would show up, but it's not working, so we'll get on with the service. Sister Dora says to remember Sister Judy Washington. She's hoping to come home tomorrow. Has been in the hospital with AFib, and heart rate is still high, but she is doing better today. And I did have an opportunity to visit with her in the hospital and pray with her today. And she looked wore out, didn't she? She looked tired. So let's remember her in prayer. Also, my grandbaby is in the hospital. Had a rash on his stomach. They didn't know what it was, and it was blistering up. So I want y'all to remember him in prayer. His name is Cyrus, I think. Cyrus, I think. They haven't officially named him yet. So they do it a little different than we do it, but he needs our prayer. So please remember my grandbaby tonight in prayer. If you have a need tonight, if you'll let it be known by slipping your hand up, would you stand? I did want to mention that we have a guided prayer service, and we don't have a slide for it, but it'll be up this weekend, November the 1st, which is the first Saturday in November. That's a Friday night, right, Craig? November the 1st is a Friday night. It's our guided prayer, and we're kicking off this. It's for the nation, for the election, for lost souls, revival. But we're also going to start a month-long fasting calendar this Sunday. So, and this is for people that will sign up, and you can would fast the whole day. You're welcome to fast meals, obviously. You're welcome to fast half a days, full days, a week, month, whatever you feel led to do. So this guided prayer and this fasting initiative that we're kicking off, it's always in order, isn't it? Remember last week I preached, told on Wednesday night, Jesus said, my house will be called a house of prayer. And there's some things that only prayer and fasting move on. Amen. So if you're like me, when Brother Kenny brought the idea, and I feel like the Lord just instantly confirmed it, because I'm not going to say no, we don't want to fast, but I really felt like the Lord kind of been speaking to my heart in those lines, and I need to fast. It's been a while, but I need to fast. And so and I'm probably not trying to be harsh, but we probably all could stand to push the plate away and to spend more time with the Lord. Amen. So why don't you bow your heads with me on that note? Let us pray together. Ask the Lord's blessings on this service tonight. Heavenly Father, we honor you tonight. Lord, we just come, Lord, with holy expectation. We come with a hunger for righteousness, a hunger for holiness, a hunger for the things of God tonight, Lord. And we bless your name. We magnify your name. We glorify you in the house tonight, Lord. May you be honored and glorified. May Christ be exalted and lifted up in this house tonight, Lord. And Lord, I pray for the young people in the back tonight in their classes, Lord, bless there. Bless in here these special needs that have been lifted up. Lord, every hand, I believe, went up. It signified, Lord, we need you to move, God. Touch Judy Washington in the hospital tonight, God. Touch my grandson, Lord, with a mighty hand tonight, God, and move upon him. We pray, Lord God, by your Spirit, Lord, would touch and move in the singing, the worship, the preaching and teaching of the Word of God. And Lord, when this service concludes, Lord, we can truly say that we have been touched, blessed, and helped. It was a good thing to come to the house of the Lord. May you be glorified when it's all said and done. You receive glory, honor, and praise. Would you remain standing? Let's sing together. Sing, church.
Since we're a little limited on our help up here, you have to sing extra, extra loud, okay? Because Brother Bateman, I want to hear you, okay? We're going to sing three verses of the hymn. It says, He keeps me singing, okay? I'm going to start it a little low. We might have to raise it up. We'll see. But if you sing low, it'll be in your key.
Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go, feasting on the riches of his grace, resting in the sheltering always looking on his smiling face. That is why I shout and sing. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go.
Soon he's coming back to welcome me far beyond the starry sky.
I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown. I shall reign with him on high. Lift your voice. And Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. And Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Strong tower, the righteous run into it, and they are saved. The name of the Lord is a strong tower, the righteous run into it, and they are saved. Bless him, church. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord, the Most High. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord, the Most High. The name of the Lord is, oh, a strong tower. The righteous run into it, and they are saved. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it, and they are saved. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I'm gonna sing. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord, the Most High. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord, the Most High. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Come on, the Most High. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. Sing, church. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord, the Most High.
Give him praise. Would you remain standing? Let's pray over the offering. Father, we take this opportunity, Lord, to present back a portion to you, Lord, what you've allowed us to have. When I think about a God who has met every need, who's promised, I'll never leave you, forsake you, I'll supply all your needs according to my riches in glory. When I think about the God that can open the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing, how can I not but help magnify and glorify the name of the King? Bless this, your people, the gift and the giver. Bless this offering. And everybody said amen. Come on, get out of your seats. Come up front or go out the back. Amen. Come on, sing it to the Lord, church. Hallelujah. Anybody want to be like the Lord? Amen. Anybody whose life want to line up? Help me, Lord, to have a mind of Christ.
Want to be a vessel.
We sing Jesus, He is Lord, just a couple of courses of that tonight.
He is Lord.
Come on, let's worship a minute, church, a moment.
He is Lord.
Hallelujah, yes.
He has. He has risen from the dead, He is Lord. And every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ.
Everybody, we'd sing this one more time. Would you lift holy hands to the Lord and sing?
He is Lord.
Let's give Him a sacrifice of our praise tonight.
He is Lord.
And He has risen from the dead.
And He is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
I want to sing this. Reach out and touch the Lord, oh, as He passes by. You will find He's not too busy to hear your heart's cry.
When I was a young boy, this brought comfort to the church.
Sing by this moment.
Hallelujah. We sing it. The old saints will lift a holy hand and say,
as He goes by, I need to reach out and touch the Lord. Oh, as He passes by, you will find He's not too busy.
Oh, He cares about what I'm crying about.
Your heart's cry. Oh, He's passed by this moment. Oh, your needs to supply. Oh, reach out and touch the Lord.
Oh, I'm going to have to sing it one more time, people.
Goes by. Oh, reach out and touch the Lord. Oh, as He passes by, well, you will find He's not too busy to hear your heart's cry. Oh, He's passing by this moment. Oh, your needs too, He's going to supply. Reach out, and touch the Lord
as He
goes by.
My. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. 1 Peter chapter 3. Thank all of y'all up here tonight. Amen. You can be seated. We're going to teach another installment of Christianity 101. And we're going to talk this passage of Scripture and this word up here. Be ready to, I'll read the whole, but the word answer, I want you to, in this particular passage of Scripture, I want us to really focus in and zero in on this word answer. What this word means is a defense, as you were, if as you were standing before a judge, defending your cause, defending yourself, before a judge. And this is your, I'll break it down hopefully with the help of the good Lord. Let's read it together. I'll read it. You just follow along. But sanctify. This word means to set apart, to consecrate. So we can't consecrate the Lord God. He's already holy. But it's getting your mind ready, regarding God as holy in what you're about to do in your hearts. And ready? And be ready always. I'm not much on getting you to repeat, but I want you to say that word always. Be ready always to give an answer to every man, that means mankind, men, women, boys, and girls, you be ready to defend the gospel, defend your faith, defend your testimony. You've already sanctified. You've regarded the Lord as holy. In your heart, your mind, your heart, your soul, and spirit is prepared now to give an answer, to defend to every man, woman, boy, or girl, that asketh you, you ready? You ready? You remember that word answer means to defend your faith, like you were defending your case before a judge, to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you. Come on now. And then it says to do it with meekness and fear. And I'm not going to spend a lot of time with the last part of the verse. Let's pray. Father, we need your touch. Father, what we're doing now is sacred. It's the word of God. Help us to rightfully divide it. Lord, we pray for that unction for the preacher, that anointing that rests upon men and women of God as they stand behind a sacred desk, that you empower us to preach and to declare holy truths out of the Scripture. Not only, Lord, that you would anoint the preacher and the speaker of the hour, Lord, but God, that you would anoint your people, Lord God. May you be a shield and a wall of fire round about us tonight. Touch our minds, Lord God. Draw us closer to you than we've ever been, Lord God. Let revelation knowledge flow because it comes from you, not from me, but let it come from you tonight. Give us a rhema word, Lord, a fresh manna from heaven, Lord God. Let it be a life-transforming event in this place. Would you say amen and amen? So the last part of this verse talks about with meekness and fear. You cannot ever witness. I'm not preaching on witnesses, part of it. But this is Christianity 101, a defense of your faith. But when you do this, you cannot testify of your faith in a way that is offensive or a way that is arrogant. You have to do it in meekness and in fear, the fear of the Lord, because if it had not been for the Lord on your side, if God in his grace and his mercy and his love and his long-suffering and he sent Holy Ghost conviction in your life and radically transformed you, if it weren't for that, you would be lost without God, possibly in a devil's hell. But blessed be the name of the Lord. God in his wonderful mercy saved everyone. I know all of us are saved, amen. You wouldn't be here on a Wednesday night if you won't, amen. Thank God for that. So we got to remember that when we give an answer, we got to do it with meekness and fear. So let's look back again. Sanctify, set this apart, regard God as holy. Understand, and I believe that we, and I mentioned this Sunday night, we lose the supernatural aspect of the gospel of Jesus Christ. What we're doing, we're fighting a supernatural battle. I'm going to give you a praise report. I got an email or a text with a video in it, and it was one of our pregnancy centers that's aligned with the one that we support, and Sister Ann and I sit on the board, and Sister Annie works there, and so we're very involved, and we love them, and they're doing a great work. But I love that you can see the supernatural in every area if you look for it. So in this video, the director is sending out, and Laura, the director of our center, she shared it with the board. She was talking about how that everything around them in the western part of the state, Asheville, you know, if anybody don't know, Asheville is a really spooky place. A lot of witchcraft, a lot of New Agers, a lot of crazy people. I'm sure there's good people up there, but Asheville has become a haven. It's kind of like the beach, Nag's Head, and places on the beach. It's become a haven for people that don't think like us. And, you know, Antifa, they create all this chaos, and they're socialist, and they're really they're fascists, what they are, and they're trying to disrupt the government, and they're really domestic terrorists is what they are. They have a major hub in Asheville. They have vandalized the pregnancy centers and churches in Asheville. It's a different world there. I'm not talking about the Good Mountain people. It's this outside influence. So they've come in, and so in this scenario, in where the western part of the state has been devastated by all of this and the hurricane and the flooding, the death and the damages, and they're still years probably from getting back to normal. The pregnancy center never lost operations. And they were still, they were without power, and then they got power. The only thing they're missing now is that they're missing the internet service. And they've got supply. They're handing out diapers and formula and baby wipes, and they're doing things. But in the midst of this, in this last month, I want you to hear me now. In this last month, five women who were abortion-minded, women that came there for their services, that were saying that abortion is on the table, it's an option. All five, those five women have decided to keep their babies. Now, let me say something to you today. When I heard that, I began to cry and speak in tongues, amen. It just moved my heart. I said, God, you're moved. Even when we don't see it in the midst of a hurricane and total devastation. But that's not only the good news. She said that the whole time we've been open, but Planned Parenthood, that butcher shop of innocent children, has been closed since this has happened. And I'm sure they're going to open back up. But God, in his suit, I'm telling you, natural disasters don't stop the work of God. He shut down Planned Parenthood, but they're saving lives. Somebody raise your hand and give God glory. I'm telling you, we're in a supernatural environment. Now, we're going to start this month-long fast. I'm so ready, Brother Kenny, thank you. I'm so ready because I just want to get closer to God, and I want to see God move. Come on and help me say amen. See, every one of us, when I say your story, here's what I'm saying. Here's where I'm going. As you can tell, I'm having a good time up here tonight. I was hoping y'all would just shout and the Holy Ghost take over and we just run, dance, shout, you know. But every one of us, we got to be ready to give an answer of the hope that lies in us. And you and I have a supernatural story. Every one of us has a real story where God intervened, interrupted. There was some type of intervention in your life by the Holy Spirit of God. It interrupted you. It changed you. It transformed you. And you now have a story to tell. So everyone, you got to be ready to share your story. You say, Brother Bateman, I'm not good at witnessing. Listen, I'm not talking, this is witnessing, but not specifically. Your story needs to be told, how God saved you, how God delivered you, how God has kept you, how God's hand has been upon you all these years. Your story doesn't end. It's still ongoing. And in the midst of all of this, God is still moving supernaturally. There's people that have no hope in this world that need to know about the hope that lies within inside of you. Every one of us has a dynamic. We need to tell them the how this happened. You know, let me interject this. I was preaching in the Benson Church of God, a district meeting years ago, and I was sharing some of my testimony and the rough stuff and rough and tumble years that I had, and I just wish it never happened, but it did. And I got, when I got done preaching, and he come up to me and he said, you know, man, your testimony is so powerful. Thank you for sharing part of it. He said, man, I got saved when I was 8 years old. He said, I've never done any of those things. All those things. And I said, brother, your testimony is powerful. How that God touched a young boy, 8 or 10 years old. And from that point on, this man's a little bit 2 or 3 years older than I am. He's a pastor also. And how that
God touched this man and watched over his life, and he has served the Lord and been in ministry all these years from a young age. That story, I told him when he was telling me his story, I said, brother, I wish I had your story. It would have saved me a lot of heartache, but I don't have his story. I can't tell his story, but I can tell my story, how that God can take a messed up, jacked up young man on his way to hell in rebellion, eyes blinded, amen, and God can have a Damascus experience for me and kick me off a high horse, and my eyes are open, and I get saved. And you know, come on, people of God, you've got to exciting story, because you say, well, mine's not that exciting. No, but yours is still a supernatural story, and you might have a better one than me. I hope you do. I'd love to hear some of them, but not right now. I'd love to, you know, your story, it wouldn't be in here in the Word of God. Now, I want you to agree with me on this. This verse would not be here if it didn't mean what it says. It says to be ready to answer every man, woman, boy, girl. And it says to be always ready. Look, you know, we're too, not y'all, but we're too ready to talk about what's wrong with the church, what's wrong with what's going on, and the negative and focus. No, let's always be ready to talk about what God has done for us. We're not going to put our head in the sand and live in a fantasy world where there's not anything negative. A battery has a positive and a negative post. It don't run without both of them. So we have to deal with that. But what about sharing the story, your supernatural, miraculous story where God has saved you? So every one of us has a story. Talk about the hows, the whys, the change. Man, this would be a great time to have everybody's before and after picture. Before Jesus and after Jesus. You remember back at Weight Watchers or whatever it was, they'd have those before and after pictures. You know, somebody got a pair of, man, have a pair of trousers out to here. And now he's as thin as I am because I ain't as thin as I used to be. Before and after, we look, oh, wow, what a radical transformation. Well, that's part of the story that you have to tell, is that maybe it's not so radical in the sense that, you know, you were in a gang and you killed somebody. But, you know, I remember somebody that hauled people off to prison. And I remember a story about a man that was there when they stoned one of the most godly men's probably ever lived, Stephen. Anybody remember Saul Tarsus and how that possibly he was a murderer? We know he assented to that martyrdom of Stephen. We know that he hauled men and women and family, boys and girls, off to prison. He persecuted Christians. Come on, church. He persecuted and put people just like us in prison because of their faith. But then he got knocked off his high horse. He became a Christian. It was a change, and it was so radical. You ready? That when he showed up around other Christians, they were not even sure. They were afraid of him. And it was so radical that when the religious people got news of what it was, they in turn wanted to kill him. They had to let him down in a basket outside of the wall to escape. Everywhere he went, they tried to kill him. They beat him. They stoned him. He was beaten three times with the whip and on shipwreck. I could go on. And finally martyred for his faith. But the same person used to kill and put to death Christians and haul them off to prison. Oh, what a change in that man's life. Woo! You know what? We read those riveting stories in the Bible, and I read them when I see him before Agrippa. And I see him, the ruler says, Paul, you almost persuaded me. Your story is so captivating and we look at the three missionary journeys and how he traveled all over that part of the country, of the world, and wrote letters to the churches, and we still preach and talk about him. Everybody has a story. And Peter here is simply saying to all of us, you got to be ready always to give every man an answer. You got to defend what God has done for you. The Bible, anybody ever read where Jesus said, if you're ashamed of me, I'm not ashamed of him. Bless God, I'm, you know, somebody said, well, you know, you that's too radical. No, look, I'm willing to share because people are out there without any hope. And Peter is saying, be ready to give them an answer for the hope that lies in you. Man, I like to tell people, man, this is the best thing that's ever happened to me. Man, I thought I used to have fun when I was out in the world, and y'all all goody two shoes. Y'all overlooked me. But when I was out in the world and was chasing all of those things and trying to find pleasure and excitement and thrills in those things, and nothing would bring any type of lasting peace and joy and contentment. But oh, when I found Jesus. Some people look for it in a bottle. Some folks look for it in a pill. Some folks look for it in some kind of drug. Others were in relationships. Some people have a gambling addiction. Some do this. On and on and on. Maybe somebody used to have the worst temper in the whole world. But when the Lord saved them, God just miraculously, they're the sweetest person that they've ever met. Oh, what a change in our lives. So, we need to talk about the highs, and I'm moving on. The highs, the whys, the change, the difference. Be able to tell people what a difference that the Lord's made in your life. Be able to articulate it. It doesn't have to be at a college professor's level. If I was to bring you up right now and just tell me, and I'm not going to do it because it's always dangerous to hand a mic to somebody in the middle of a service. Not with you, but good people. But be willing to come up here and I hand you a mic and you tell me how you changed after the Lord saved you. It's powerful, people, because it tells a supernatural story of a supernatural experience of a supernatural, all-powerful God that intervened in your life. Anybody ever watch? I can't watch them, but I tried to watch them, but I don't listen to cursing, but there's a show on television, very powerful. I don't have one of those genie things that X them out, but the gist of it is when a family comes together,
it's called Intervention.
The Intervention. I've never been able to watch it all the way through. But they come together. There's somebody, and most of the time the story starts off, Billy Bob's drinking 30 beers a day. And the family's saying, we got to do what we got to do to intervene. And all the family comes together and they pull together and they get doctors and therapists and they try to talk this young Billy Bob to going in, and it's a battle and a struggle. And they finally get him to detox center somewhere, and hopefully there's a good end to the story. Well, our Heavenly Father don't need nobody else to make an intervention in our lives. God has a way, listen to me, and I prayed it and you prayed it too, and I prayed this way, God, whatever it takes to see my boys come to the Lord, Lord, I'm willing, and that's a hard prayer, but I'm telling you, God has the power to intervene, and when he does, oh, what a story. I don't know if he'll ever come, maybe he will. And I don't know, he's kind of like myself. When you've been in ministry as long as he has and I have, you don't share your testimony as the official version of it, bits and pieces. You don't share it as much because it's still part of you, but you're multifaceted. Your ministry is more than just your testimony. That may be a little hard for you to digest. But my buddy, my brother, he was a mentor to me. He was a great influence in my life as a young man. He's an African-American preacher. He's about 10 years older than I am now. And he influenced my life in such a powerful way. But he has one of the greatest testimonies I have ever heard. He shot, he was a drug dealer on the streets, I believe, of Charlotte. He shot another drug dealer in a drug deal that went bad and killed him. He went to court. They gave him the death penalty. He went to death row. Come on, folks. They don't get no worse than that. He went to death row in North Carolina. Spent, I don't know, years and years and years on death row. We had a Republican governor back in the 70s named Jim Holzhauser. Anybody else who had that was scheduled for execution, North Carolina back then was still executing people. And by the way, I'm for executions. I'm not against it. It's the way that you read it. It's in the Bible. Come on, say amen or owe me either one. Wow. Okay. So they were going to execute Brother Robert. And by this time, I don't think he'd give his heart to the Lord yet. The only person that Governor Jim Holzhauser gave a reprieve on the execution in the 8 years he was governor was Robert. The only one. Everybody else was executed. State execution in the death chambers of North Carolina. Death sentence was then commuted to life in prison without parole. God then worked it out, miraculously and wondrously saved him, that he was able to navigate through the system, and he got so well ingrained in the system. He was in a prison that was minimum security. He went to work every day at a Dollar General or something. And do you know, the thing that when I met him was watching all of the guards in the prisons and the officers and even the superintendent of the whole prison come to him for prayer. Wow. To an inmate, a former death row, a convicted murderer. But I can tell you why, because they knew his story and they saw his life. They understood the power of God that had transformed him for what he was, and he had such influence. And when he would get out, he would and go to different places during the work week. There would be people of the community of influence in the community that would sponsor him to go out to their churches. Pastors would come in and get him to share his story. Why? Listen to me. I know that's a dramatic, unbelievable almost story, but I'm telling you, a story gives people hope. And he was one of my mentors, one of my spiritual fathers. Man, he was rough. I thought he was mean. Man, we'd meet every day at 5 o'clock to pray, and I went out there one day and said, "Hey man, it's raining today." And we're out there walking the track at 5 o'clock in the morning, praying, showing me the disciplines and it helped formed who I am today. And we still talk from time to time. But what an influence. I'm telling you, if God can do that for him, what can he do for others? We have to understand that's how supernatural and powerful a story that this man has. And he impacted and oh my goodness, when he would preach, you would sit there and say, oh my goodness, they were so anointed and so blessed. Maybe he'll come and visit with us. He probably won't share his testimony. He'll just preach what God gives him. You have to live out your faith before others. You say, well, Brother Bateman, all right, now I'm going to get to the basics. So this is Christianity 101. What do we need to do? Number one, you need to have a basic understanding of the Word of God. You ain't got to be a Bible scholar to tell somebody what God has done for you, but you do need to have some understanding of what salvation is and what sin is. Make no mistake about it. We have failed miserably in the modern Americanized church. We have sanitized sin. We have made it like it's a problem and we're not calling it what it is. Listen to me, people of God. Sin will damn your soul to hell. Sin will separate you. Sin is a rebellion and transgression against God's laws. Amen. David said, you ready? I have hid your word in my heart that I might not sin against thee. We need to have some basic understanding. One translation put this verse on, I don't remember which one it was. It says, if someone asked you about your Christian hope, you got to be ready to explain it. You don't have to be a Bible scholar. You don't have to be a Greek scholar. You can simply be able to share with them how sin separates us from a relationship with God, and through His Son, Jesus Christ, we can be reconciled in right standing. You know, when I'm in a lot of times when I'm praying in hospitals or anywhere else that I'm praying for somebody that I've been called to pray, I pray this way. God, we thank, and I end it this way. God, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who died upon that cross, shed that blood. Forgive us of our sins so that we could be in right relationship with the Lord. That's the way I pray. Even if they don't understand or if they don't hear it prayed or they weren't expecting that, I'm going to leave them with the thought that I need to be in right relationship with God. And I need to be able to explain just for my own self. Now, I consider myself somewhat of an amateur theologian. I've been studying the scriptures for nearly 33 years now, poring over them, dividing the words of God, studying the Greek and the Hebrew. I'm no Greek and Hebrew scholar. I'm not saying this to boast. This is what I do. So I have a better handle maybe than the average person. I've still got a long way to go and a lot to learn. More people have forgot more than I know. But I'm telling you, you don't have to be a preacher. You don't have to be a Bible scholar and a Greek theologian and a Hebrew scholar. You need to understand what God has done for you and be able to share it with somebody and the hope. And he said to be always ready to give an answer, to give a defense. Come on and say amen. One way of sharing this with somebody is, I'll give you an illustration, a couple of more points and I'm done. Woman was sharing a testimony along these lines. I was doing some research. She said, I had a friend raised in church like I was, but it strayed away. And so when it came time for them, they got come together and have lunch. It was a man and a woman. From what I understood, what I could discern through this story was they were just friends. And he told this young lady who is a Christian, he said, I'm agnostic, which means he's not really sure. A good way of explaining agnostics, not atheist, but you really don't know whether God's real or not. You don't know. And so it upset her, and she began to say, God, how can I share with him? How can I convince him? What can I do? And so she began to pray about it, and she shared some thoughts along these lines. She told him, and I don't remember if this is exactly from that particular commentary. She said, but one way I know that God is real, because she's talking to an agnostic who doubts whether or not God is really real. She said, I can feel his presence. Anybody know what I'm talking about? I can feel his presence. My goodness, boy, brothers and sisters, if we could get some of these folks that have never known the Lord to just feel for a moment what we feel. Come on, somebody. Praise God. If we could just, the Bible talks about that wheel turning inside, that wheel inside of a wheel, amen. Jeremiah said, it's like a fire shut up in my bones, amen. Dear God, the joy of the Lord, amen. I'm full of his joy. I'm full of his power. I can sense his presence. Dear Lord above, I can be up here, not just here, but anywhere, but especially in the house of God, and somebody can sing or somebody can, we can be worship, and I can all of a sudden, anybody know what I'm talking about? Just feel his presence. That video I watched a while ago about the pregnancy center, I watched it and I began to weep as she talked about the people that had been saved and the babies that had been saved. And see, I don't know about you, but That makes me, I can't do a backflip, never have, never will. And I can tell you this, it made me want to do a spiritual backflip. I began to weep and I began to pray in the Holy Spirit and pray in tongues and just, I felt His presence. I'm sharing that with you. I'm telling you, that's, you know that. And if sometimes we forget what a supernatural God we serve. God wants to touch His people. Tell people God will touch you, that you can really feel this. I don't know about you, but I can feel it. Bless God. She said, I can hear His voice. I was praying this morning, 3 o'clock in the morning, on a specific thing, and I heard His voice clearly. Not an audible voice. I've never heard the audible voice of God. It'd be great. I've never heard it. I know Jesse Duplantis has. No, he hasn't. He's a liar. But I've heard the Lord's voice as He spoke to me in my inward man. You say, Brother Bateman, you're preaching to the choir. We all know this. That's why you got to be ready to give an answer. To tell somebody, God speaks to me. Does God speak to anybody here? Come on in, affirm it and say amen. God, you got to be, God, you can feel His presence. God speaks to you. I don't know how He does speaks to you. He speaks to me through the Word of God primarily. This is the number one way God speaks to me. Other times it's in my meditation on the things of God. I'm thinking about God. I'm meditating on Him. I put myself in a position to get quiet so that I can be still and know that He's God. This is what I can tell somebody. You can hear God's voice. Yes, He speaks to us. He'll guide us. Come on, let me close with these two points. Part of my story is I can tell that every time that I've been through something, God has comforted me. Every time I've gone through a tribulation, trial, temptation, attack from the pits of hell, every battle that the devil had designed to take me out, the Spirit of the Lord lifted up a standard. Every single time that I've ever faced anything, there's been one constant. God has been with me through it. Yes. That's a powerful testimony. People that are lost, that don't have any hope, that are bound and addicted and troubled and in chains, they need to know there is a God, amen, that will deliver them and walk with them the rest of their day. Remember, He said, I'll never leave you. Woo!
All right, I'm closing. You say, Brother Bateman, we shared my testimony. It's powerful. It's convincing. I'm defending my faith. I'm defending the faith. I'm defending. I'm giving a man an answer. I'm a man, a woman, boy, or girl. I'm ready. But what if they don't accept the Lord? You do your part and you release them into the hands of God. I know you're tired of my story. I'm tired of it sometimes. But I had praying mama, praying daddy, praying grandparents, praying people in the church. And it seems like the more they prayed, the worse I got. I've been there. I've experienced it praying for my own children. The more you pray, the seem, but you've got to, you be ready to give an answer. When I witness to my children, when I do, don't think I don't, when I witness to my lost children, I remind them of my story. This is what God has done for me. And then I release them to God. Would you stand?
You study.